how he's built and how we use him throughout the years. So first of all, a little bit about me. I have an electronics degree from Cal State Long Beach. I'm a programmer in the biometrics field. So we program fingerprinting systems and identification systems for police and law enforcement and U.S. Army.
No, the robot.
I wanted a challenge. That's why I built him. I wanted this thing to be useful. I was trying to look for something to do, you know, but I needed to be useful. I wanted it to be unique and possibly lead me to some kind of adventure. And this is what I came up with and thought about building. So I started about 2002 and I finished in 2003. So it took about 11 months to do the first go around of it. I'm still making little modifications as needed, but not necessarily anything. There are blueprints and everything available in the R2 Builders Club, and you can find them at astromech.net if you guys wanted to build one. So really, you don't need that many tools to build this thing. All I used here was a table saw, a chop saw, a router, and a Dremel tool. And this is all the tools that I used to create this thing here. So no CNC machines or anything fancy like that. No 3D printers.
Thank you, Puppy!
We in the R2 Builders Club encourage you to build with whatever materials you like. So this one's primarily, a lot of it is made out of wood, the structure. The outside has a lot of aluminum in it. We also, it depends on what you want it to do. Some people like to sit it in their living room and not move at all. I like to take it out and use it, make sure it's movable and with remote control pieces that are very professional. So what I wanted to do is start with the hardest part here. I don't know if we want to turn down the lights a little so I can see it.
Okay.
This right here is the shoulder piece that you see, and it doesn't look very complicated, but it has, it's a 7-layer piece, and each one is indented just a little bit, so it's like a staggered thing.
Well, what come here?
So, what, it was kind of difficult to create, so I did spend 3 weeks doing this, and then decided it didn't look good enough, and I decided to scrap the whole thing. So, a measure of your success is not through the failures, it's through quitting or not quitting. So I decided I would fail that part and not quit, and thus you see the thing before you. So that the legs are also made out of plywood. A lot of people will look at them and think they're aluminum or some other kind of material, but they're actually 3 layers of plywood, as you see here. They are glued together, and then the sides are of automotive putty, filling putty, to make them nice and smooth. And they look and they feel smooth and they look like metal. The frame inside of it is made out of plywood. Now you'd think a robot, why would I use plywood? Why would plywood be a building material? Plywood's very strong. As a matter of fact, in World War II, one of the fighter bombers in the beginning of the war for England was called the De Havilland Mosquito. It was called the Wooden Wonder. The inner structure and the airframe was created with plywood, and then the outside was skin. And it was actually one of the fastest fighters in the beginning of the war, fighter bombers, and it served throughout the entire war as an effective fighter. So wood frame is good. I also like it because I can screw things to the sides of it here, like electronics and things, without drilling into aluminum, for instance, and tapping and drilling or having to have a nut or something behind it. I can just take a screw with a screwdriver, corner the screwdriver, and just screw it right into the frame. And that's come in handy many times. So here he is sitting in my living room very early on when he was still a baby. He's sitting on a bucket because I wanted to make sure he looked like R2. When you're building something, you always want to see what it looks like as you're building. So here he is with part of his drivetrain right here. This is the skirt piece, and it's a piece that a lot of people don't see in R2. It's the very bottom of his body. This was made with plywood you see here, plywood scraps actually from the frame. But this outer piece right here is made from poster board. Huh. So it's the regular poster board that kids use. I was comfortable with it. I could shape it the way I wanted to. So I have three layers of poster board there. And that's what's on the frame for the skirt. Here is an aluminum foot that I borrowed from a friend, and I mimicked it with pieces of PVC. So you can buy straight pieces of PVC from builder's places. And this pipe, this is a PVC pipe cut into quarters to make this little curved piece here. So that will be right here on this foot. Here he is standing again with little pieces of metal, which he'd probably fall over at this point if he didn't have those there. And his first day in the sun right here. So what do you really need to know to build a remote control thing? It's not really that complicated once you look at it. People will think it's moving around. I'm magically moving it with my remote control system. But it's pretty simple. A remote control system that you buy from the store, out of the box, will come with these groups of things right here. One is a transmitter I'm holding. The other one is a receiver, which is in the robot. And it'll come with a battery pack and probably a servo. Now the servo has a little arm that just moves back and forth. So all you would do is plug the battery in here, plug the servo into here, and turn these on, and you'll be able to do something like this.
So cool.
Right, so the operation of that is usually for an airplane where you're going to move the ailerons, or you're going to move the flaps in a certain way so the plane would turn. So that's a very simple system, very simple things you can do with it without any modifications. This group over here is add-ons to that. This is called a speed controller, and this is one of the main motors, and a bigger battery. So what that does is when you plug the speed controller into here, you obviously can't control this motor with this little bit of battery power. So all you would do is plug this motor into here. It's clearly marked motor 1. And then this battery would plug in, this where it says battery, plus and minus. And you'd plug these two into the receiver here. And that's it. Without any further wiring, then you can make them do things like drive around. A little further with some of the pieces that aren't pictured here, you'd be able to make them speak. And the sound cards are not hard to put together. And, he's got a memory card inside of him so that I can basically unplug or eject and put sounds on it, different sounds if I wanted to. Plug it back in and get the sounds out of it. So what we've used them for, this is one of the events here. You see Chopper back here if you guys watch the Rebel series. And this was at a children's hospital in LA that we went to visit the kids with. We used to do and still do a lot of work with the 501st Legion, which is the bad guys costuming club for Star Wars. They dress in stormtroopers and Darth Vader and these bad characters. Go to a lot of those. We've been to the City of Hope multiple times. Here's my wife here, Amy, that's sitting in the chair right there. There's her dog on there. And my two little kids when they were little tiny kids. They used to judge their height growth based on the height of R2 to see when they would, their goal was to get taller than R2. And now they are way taller than me. So here we are at Totally Kids, visiting the kids there. Loma Linda, Muscular Dystrophy Association, and their walk as well. Children's Hospital. We do some professional stuff. This is with the Pacific Symphony. Actually, we were there this weekend doing another concert series with them, with R2. But this is Richard Kaufman, one of their composers. And here's where, actually, in 2005, Lucasfilm saw us and started our contracting career with them. This was a charity screening of one of the last films, Return of the Sith, or Revenge of the Sith. And it was, we were on the red carpet, and we were just taking photos of the people as they were coming in. And they saw some of those photos and started asking us to do jobs then in Los Angeles. So some of them were, we were on the float for Lucasfilm in 2007. We shot a commercial here for Verizon. Now, you would think that these things are like so exciting and adventuresome, right, to be on a set. They're actually very, very stressful, especially for something like this. You'll see R2's on a dais, about a 4x4 dais. It's about 8 inches or a foot off of the ground. So you're working in a studio with a lot of electronic interference. You don't know what's going on in there. You're on a dais, and they're asking you to move the robot back and forth, spin around, and do different things. Now, at any point in time, if I were to lose control, if you don't buy the top-of-the-line electronics, your signal can get knocked up, and he would end up driving off of the edge. So that was on my mind for about 12 hours that day. The next thing they wanted me to do is, when they called me for this commercial, they wanted me to recreate the antenna that pops out from Empire Strikes Back when he's looking for Luke Skywalker. So they wanted it done in 3 weeks. So it was during Christmas time, so I had some time off of work, and I said, yeah, sure, I can get that done. I said, one of three things will happen. Either there'll be something I plug in there, and then it'll just start moving, or it'll be something that we go in the back and push up, or it'll be fully automated. So I told them, I'll tell them within a week which one it's going to be. So I ended up really being able to do what they wanted, and they were very appreciative. And the agency actually told me, if this thing wasn't created and if I didn't do it, the commercial would have never happened. So I helped employ, I don't know, 40 or so people for that weekend for this commercial, and actually helped get it on the air. So hopefully this thing will go up, and I'll show you. So here it goes. So he'd still be able to move. So this, currently this is probably the only working replica of this in the world at this point. Other guys have tried to get at least pop up, but it doesn't have the motion. So what needs to happen here is there's two microchips. One's controlling the top, one's controlling the bottom motion. So what happens, what I found out, is with a power antenna, there's a natural, I don't know, curve or something when it comes down. So when the antenna's going up and down, the tip curves just a little bit and goes back in and comes back up. So the curve of this and the size of this fits barely into this pie panel. So you have to take into account, it has to know where it is turning and at what point it's turning. And when it stops, it has to know it has to stop at a certain spot in order for it to be able to fit into there. So when you see this go down, you'll see the head stop and turn and plop in. If it's off by half an inch on either side, it's gonna bind and stick. Okay, so for a 3 week development time, I didn't have time to debug a whole lot of it. So if I hit a sequence of buttons, the actual microchip would fry up in there. So luckily I didn't hit that sequence, and I kept my wits about me. But for the entire 12-hour day, it worked about 120 times, going up and down. Every single shot that they did, and every single 30-second little bit, it was in view. So it had to pop up every single time they started talking. So 120 times. By the time it was over, after the 12 hours, I was nearly dead. My mind was just blown away, and I just wanted to get out of there. But it was very, very stressful. And mind you, if the thing did go wrong, or if the thing burned out or didn't work at the time, they would sit and wait for me until I fixed it, which would mean, again, 30 or 40 people sitting around waiting, draining hours of salary, I guess, and keeping the production costs up. So a lot of pressure. This was a Toyota commercial that showed in Tokyo, or showed in Japan. It was a Prius. It was a two-day shoot. It was pretty fun, but it was pretty hot for that guy. It's pretty good. It was in the 90s that day, but it was a lot of fun to do. So one of the peaks that we had was when Lucasfilm was sold to Disney. We were going to a mysterious magazine shoot, and it ended up being Bob Iger, the head of Disney, Kathleen Kennedy, the new head of Lucasfilm, and Mickey Mouse and my R2. And we were on the cover in the centerfold of Bloomberg Business Week for the announcement of the selling of the company. So what I like to do is share all my stuff. So this is a party I call R2LA, a gathering. This is the first one in 2003. There's about 12 guys here. My droid's almost finished. The thing was, I didn't know how fast people were building. So I thought people were building like crazy. I knew nobody in the business. I knew nobody in the...